Welcome to the San Francisco Dance Film Festival's interview series. I'm Linda Schaller, and with me today is the Irish producer, director, writer, Ruan Magan. His documentary, The Steps of Freedom, The Story of Irish Dance, is one of our feature films in the Spring Film Festival, Stage to Film. It's an extraordinary story of how Irish dance evolved over the centuries from a simple folk dance to a global phenomenon loved by millions all over the world. So welcome. Nice to have you here.
Oh, thanks, Linda. I can't tell you how excited. Do you know what? I have to say one thing before we talk about anything else, is that I really wish that there were the 35 musicians, the 75 dancers, the 5 choreographers, all of the amazing people who told the story, and all of the 70-odd crew with me here. It's about 200 people came together to make this film. And as you know, all films are collaborations of a kind, but this one, so I kind of feel a little bit embarrassed being here representing the film, because there really should be 200 people sitting here with me.
Well, I want to tell the audience a little bit about you, though. You're internationally known for your documentaries and drama series. You've been honored with multiple film festival awards for the documentary The Hunger, The Irish Revolution, 1916, The Irish Rebellion, and Waterloo Warriors. And Bonza, the love story, it's a love story, gained an Emmy and a Peabody, while the drama series The Men Who Made America was awarded 2 Emmys. Now, this is just a very short list of your projects, but when you look at all those titles, you see a theme arising of history, and particularly Irish history. I mean, has history always been your passion?
My father was very interested in history, and he died young, so perhaps I'm trying to, maybe I'm chasing something there. But I think, yeah, they're all about Irish history, or there certainly is a common theme, but maybe that's the story that I can pursue best. But there is always, I think, hopefully, universality about the stories that we pursue. So you look at the story of 1916, it's about revolution, but it's about the Enlightenment, it's about something that's very current today, particularly in the last few months. It's about, you know, a culture that's very precious that developed over 300 or 400 years, the idea that everybody could be free, or should have the right to be free, and to define their lives the way that they should see fit. And ultimately, in Ireland, we had a revolution. But if you look at that documentary, it goes back to the American Revolution, goes back to the French Revolution, goes to all the ideas that developed through the Enlightenment. So I would hope that although they have a common Irish theme, they always sort of take a much broader look, or remit.
Mm-hmm. Well, most documentarians know that when they start a project, they have to be really honest with themselves and say, is this a topic I can love perhaps for a very long time? And I think in your case, of Steps of Freedom, it was 7 years. Mm. So I have to ask you, what was the decision-making process and the inspiration behind the idea of taking on such a large topic of Irish dance?
So I've done a few stage shows, sort of big epic things in stadiums, and worked with dancers. And I think that just really caught me and fascinated me. It's incredible how dancers have this capacity to say so much more than you can with words or images, or something very different than you can with words and images, through their bodies. And I was just became utterly fascinated. And working with dancers as well is a real privilege. Anyone who has had that opportunity will understand what I'm talking about. Dancers they are in a flow that the rest of us mortal humans aren't. And there's a magic there. So I was kind of fascinated with dance. And then the other thing is okay, Riverdance and Michael Flatley shows have been phenomenally successful. I mean, it's mind-boggling. It's estimated something like 2 billion people have watched Riverdance alone on television and stage. I was interested, well, why? You know, yes. The music that Bill Whelan did in Riverdance is kind of wonderful, and some of the dances are just extraordinary to behold. But then it's been played in lots of different ways, different music and different dances, and it still mesmerizes audiences. So why? And so that was the question I set out to find. I think the documentary, as you say, ultimately ends up being something slightly different from that. It doesn't pose that question at the beginning, at least as explicitly as it was in my mind at the beginning. And the first word is spoken by an African-American, Lenny Sloan, and for good reason. Because what I found out, maybe, I mean, I can't tell you exactly why it's such a huge phenomenon, why Irish dance has become it, but it's partly because of the percussive element, which seems to go back at least 600 years, but probably goes back a couple of thousand as being part of it. It's partly because there's no such thing as Irish dance. It's a dance that has assimilated many other dances. It's so in a way, because Ireland was an island nation and always having to trade out, and still, we're still like that, we're a very open people, the dance took on a lot of other people's dances. And so maybe people, audiences around the world are seeing this. It's not just a singular culture.
I think in the very beginning of the documentary, you set up a lot of these story threads. And the percussive is the one that really took my interest, because there was a quote that says, it is not only dancing to music, it is dance as music. So what does that mean in Irish dance exactly?
Wow, this came out in the making of the film, which I hadn't understood before, is that the dancer, it's as if they're playing an instrument, but the body is the instrument. It's that simple. So if a dancer and a musician play together, the musician has to be hearing the body, the sounds of the body, as acutely as the dancer is hearing the music that the musician is making. That's how it was always with Irish dance. It's interesting, if you go way back, we were, most of this dance, it's a traditional peasant dance. I'm loath to use that word in the Irish context, but that's what it is. And so a lot of these people, a lot of it comes out of poverty, people who just had very little, I'm not saying poverty, they lived very, very simple lives. So they could dance with each other and make sound, make the music just with their bodies, just with their feet and their hands. They could dance with just somebody accompanying on a pair of spoons. They could dance with somebody on a jaws harp. They could dance with somebody just lilting. So from very little, they could create something splendid and beautiful.
But I do want to go back to the beginning in a film, and you mentioned the African-American or the African culture thing. One of the first scenes we see is in the city of New York in a street intersection, and there is African-American dancer Morgan Bullock, and you can hear her percussive rhythm and she speaks. But, you know, I think that many people would not have expected that dancer or that scene at the beginning. So why was it important to you to introduce her so early in the film?
Well, there's a few reasons. Well, the first week thing, of course, Morgan has no Irish connections. So by choosing to dance in the Irish style or form, she's bearing witness to the fact that it's now gone beyond Irishness. We don't own it anymore. If we ever owned it at all, we definitely don't own it anymore. So it's become like Greek dancing or ballet or tango, or, you know, which is an extraordinary thing in and of itself. And that's the only, I suppose, that's the reason we're making the film. It wouldn't be of any interest except that that's happened. The other reason is Irish dance was very profoundly influenced by the confluence of the Irish and people of African origin in North America. And that happened over many centuries, initially on the slave plantations, as the film shows, where Irish indentured servants, it must be very clear, they weren't slaves. So they had a few advantages, but they lived side by side, worked cheek by jowl with Africans. So inevitably there was a sharing of culture, and that continued then on work camps, on massive infrastructure projects. I think what's very interesting though is those early Irish immigrants were going to America, going to Barbados with a dance that was, I suppose, freer. It hadn't been restricted, or if they were going with it with a restricted body, it opened up when they got to America. I think that's fascinating. So that the Irish dance that you see evolve in America is always just that little bit. It's got an edge, it's got a freedom, it's got a passion, perhaps a sexuality that you don't see in Ireland. And you could also contend that the Irish dance masters who went out subsequently in the 1800s, 1900s, would go out with their dance, but then they'd see how the Irish were doing it in America, go, oh, and loosen up as well, you know? So if you look at someone like Donnie Golden, he just has that thing, right? It's American, right? And so he's Irish-American, he's you know, a lot of Riverdance, a few steps in Riverdance were designed by Donnie Golden. So the quintessential Irish dance show has some of this American Irish, and I don't mean Irish American, I mean American Irish dance form in it. It's a different thing.
Even in the film, it said that there was a quote that really struck me that said that Riverdance, you know, because of Gene Butler and Michael Flattery, Irish American, that kind of form of dancing would never risen to that level had they not been American. So I'm curious, do you agree with that? And how did your Irish viewers take that?
Irish viewers had no problem at all with that. I mean, we completely understand that it was an Ireland, and that Ireland died the day Riverdance hit the stage. Right now, obviously, economically, socially, culturally, we were loosening up in the 70s and 80s anyway. And Riverdance is kind of, in Irish, you'd say a bruchpointer. It's like the punctuation point of that. Yes, there's a truth in that statement that you say about Flatley and Butler. But if you go back and you unwind that, you always end up finding African Americans. So because the you know, Gene Kelly would never have danced the way he did if he wasn't hoofing it on the streets of Chicago, or having to, you know, some guy walks up to him, an African American, says, "Hey, you know, dance, or I won't lay you down this street," you know, and they dance off against each other. And this is the way people just were. It was part of life, and they were always trading taps, at least not always, but the last, say, you know, for 200 years, they were definitely doing that. And it's just a beautiful part of culture which isn't documented well enough, is how people use dance as a way to go, "Hey, I'm the boss. It's lovely."
No, I think one of my favorite scenes in the film is that competition between the tap dancers and the Irish dancers. And it's almost like, let's dance instead of fight. And I'm just curious, you also have incredible archival footage throughout the documentary, really showing how those cultures blended and mixed and the history behind it. But in modern day time, when you see that competition, how do you see that affecting both of those styles now?
I think I'd like to answer it like this, is that all dance continues to evolve just as much as we evolve, or culture evolves. So nothing ever stays, you know. So in Ireland, we had this fallacy that we thought Irish dance was just this way, and that was the end of it. And we bought into that because we needed to, I suppose, for a cultural revolution, which we document. So whereas now in Ireland, we would look at Irish dance and just see it, love it, that it's evolving differently in Russia than it is in America, than it is in Ireland and in India. It's always different. It's always, and the same is true of tap, and the same is true of all the sort of different versions of dance that evolved out of that.
I do want to go back to the biggest, boldest statement that starts the film. Irish dance is born out of oppression. I mean, and that is like, there's so many ways that plays out in the film. Can you just highlight just a couple of those?
There's a scene much later, which was maybe the first scene that I knew I wanted to film. And that was in Kilmainham Jail with dancers dancing in the cells. And my grandmother was in prison there three times, and she went on hunger strike several times. And one of the times she was in hunger strike for 31 days, which we as children were fascinated by. We used to ask her all the time, "What's it like to go on hunger strike?" And she would never answer because she didn't want. She'd just say, "Oh, they were all heroes." She never wanted to talk about herself. But one day she did, and she said, "Okay, I'll tell you what it's like to go on hunger strike." She said, "My skin never looked so good." So that was her. So she was part of this revolution, and as she points out, with many, many tens of thousands of people. And she had told me that they used to dance to keep warm, and it would also drive the warders mad, right? Because right. So, but that all comes out of this idea then of dance being, as Gene Butler puts it, it's a dance of resistance. And the body is resisting. And sure, you know, unlike, say, with ballet, where it's just extraordinarily effusive and the whole body is in work, the Irish, it's hardly anything's going on. And yet so much is being said. And some theories would suggest that is kind of a martial art. And it's Irish people saying, well, you know, we're not going to take up arms against you, but you can't beat us. And that this, and if you just look at how that is, you know, how the body is presented by Irish dancers, that kind of does make sense. And yes, you can track it the whole way back to the 1500s, 1600s, where the dance is documented by many, many people to be quite loose and quite free until about the 1700s, at which point you get this incredible wave of dancing masters who are very poor itinerants who would wander around the country, living at the mercy of one village to the next village, and they would teach in return for room and board. But they would also say, you know, don't be cowed, you know, stand up for yourself and say it. Just say it however you can.
But the priests came in and sort of changed that, didn't they?
The church definitely comes into it later. And in this crazy Ireland that we built after we got independence, this strange, puritanical, censured, you know, tight-minded place where all the radicalism that had fueled the revolution is just got rid of. But I mean, jazz music was banned. I mean, you know, you couldn't wear any sort of clothes that were in any way strange. Our lovely Irish American cousins would come over and they would just be slagged for being different, you know. So we were a weird people, and we let the church control too many things, including dance. There's a shame in that. But then, you know, then it all ended and we just jumped out of it.
That's
which
right.
We've done now.
Well, you've jumped to Riverdance, and some say that there was a quote that said, the Riverdance put the sex back into Irish dance. So yeah. It continues to evolve, I think. And in fact, you know, but it's not the last evolution of dance. I'm sure you've seen others. I'm sure you've seen many new Irish dance companies literally all over the world. And it is sort of, you know, there's a Broadway show called Paradise Square. And and at the end of your film, you show many dance companies, Irish dance companies of every nationality, I think, that we could think of. And it just feels like it keeps evolving. And it feels like you've sort of left the door open to continue the story. Do you think there'll be a part two?
You know what? It's so funny you say that. I was only just talking about that today. And I'd love to. There's so much we left unsaid. And as you say, I think my regret about the film is we didn't let what's gone on now speak more. Now it is in there. I mean, all those dance sequences, which were so beautifully performed, were performed by dancers who were doing really amazing things. I mean, if I just mentioned Edwina Guckey and Alone, who's one of the choreographers who helped, she managed to keep the precious flame of her dance, of her grandfather and great-grandfather's dance alive through all these years where, you know, to dance in this sort of traditional Shano style was just not seen as appropriate at all. And has now turned that into a mini revolution in Irish dance, where she's collaborating with all sorts of amazing people online, all over the world, in Ireland. Really incredible. And so there's a lot of Edwinas now emerging. And I would predict that there's going to be an explosion in the form in all sorts of different ways.
Well, I do hope we see part two, because we would all love to see that. And I do want to thank you for being with us today and for giving insights to your beautiful documentary, which, by the way, have stunning landscapes in them and wonderful archival footage. So please, I hope we get to interview for part two someday.
Great. Well, look, thank you so much, Linda, for having us. Yeah. Okay.
Well, Steps of Freedom, The Story of Irish Dance, it's entertaining, informative, and it's the feature in our spring festival. It'll be May 13th at the Brava Theater. You can visit our website for more information and tickets, and we hope to see you all there. All right, thanks.